Welcome to West Hollywood, California, birthplace for one of the dirtiest, the most sleaziest, the darkest, the most honest hard rocking band that ever was.
Welcome to the jungle. We got fun and games. We got everything you want. How do we know the name?
No other blues-based hard rock band changed the musical landscape as much as Guns N' Roses did. With ex-Gunner Slash, Duff McKagan, and Matt Sorum launching Velvet Revolver. And Axl Rose planning a new Guns N' Roses record, we thought we'd give you the history and bring you up to date on the story of Guns N' Roses.
You're gonna get some people listening to the record. You know, they're going to compare it to Gunners, they're going to compare it to the Snake Pit stuff, maybe even STP, maybe even The Cult. It's almost like you're competing with your past.
You record something, you know, you put everything into it when you're doing it. When it's done, you don't really look back. So I suppose I could get very analytical if I grabbed all the records that I've ever done or whatever and sat there and compared this one to that one, which is something, an objective that other people might have.
I don't think we looked back making this record. We didn't look back or think about it or talk about it or anything. It's just us now moving forward, playing music.
I have that same feeling. There's this intuition that I know this is going to work.
There's a lot of similarities about this band and that band back then, the way that it started. So that's sort of cool because I can relate to that, and it's exciting in that sense because I love that whole aloof, can go for broke kind of attitude. Not thinking too far into the future, just do what you have to do now and just and make it rock, you know?
You're just five regular guys. You're just a band, you know? And the fact that you became popular enough to get in the public eye and be part of the media and all that crap, you know, it doesn't mean you have to change your personality or anything like that. If people don't like it, then you don't. Guns N' Roses record. In other words, it's what our Guns N' Roses, five kids,
right. You know,
an album based on the daily lives of five kids, basically. You know, it's not pro or con anything. It just says this, it says that.
I mean, it's a true story about five guys going through the ringer of Hollywood, you know? And so all things that are talked about on the record are true things, you know?
And some of the stuff is really shocking, but there's nothing dishonest about it.
If you look at GNR, how we started, it was just, you know, two guitars, bass, drums, and vocals. And we played wherever we could, wherever, you know, wherever we could get a gig.
We're not that big of a deal, you know? We're just a rock and roll band.
When Guns N' Roses started, it was all about just a rock and roll band. It was about being sort of like toe-to-toe with the audience.
The scene that you came out of back then, can that ever happen again here?
We weren't part of that scene. We were the antithesis of it. Poison, Motley Crue, Quiet Riot, and all that. We weren't part of that scene. We were like the anti-scene. What was going on way back in the day couldn't be recreated, not with any amount of paint or makeup.
What's great about the strip is, you know, you can go from, you know, the Roxy's playing something to the Cat Club to the Whiskey. They're all within a block of each other. And you can get, you know, four different styles of music there. But you know you're going to get entertained, you know. And then you can go to the Rainbow at the end of the night and find out who you're taking home. That's great, man. It's great.
We started out opening up for sleaze bands on a fucking Sunday or Monday night in some cheap club and started there. And then we'd get enough response where we'd open up on a Tuesday, open up on a Wednesday. You keep moving forwards. And so we just keep, you know, one foot in front of the other.
You guys have been blowing the headlining acts right off the stages.
We don't go out there just like to blow away the headlining act. That's not the point. But some of the headlining acts are sort of boring.
It was during the second or third week of the Aerosmith tour that our usual 70 people were up front, you know, out of 17,000. You know, and those were our fans, and we knew it, you know. We knew we weren't going to apply to everybody who was there. But the next week, there were 700 people that were raising their fists to us. And the next week, there were 7,000. And to us, it's to see that, you know, from one week to the next. And the week after that, it was all 17,000 people with Guns N' Roses banners. And it was absolutely magical.
We just were completely different, and we just were lucky. Look at Guns N' Roses, you know. I don't think anybody had any idea it was gonna explode like it did, you know.
People hold Appetite as this landmark release. Looking back, can you see why?
The thing was is that everything that happened as from the time that we recorded it, which was an amazing f***ing trip, just making that record. And then when we went out and we were opening for the f***ing Cult, we went out and played the songs, and it's the actual album. I never realized it was going to be as iconic as it turned out to be. You know what I'm saying? So now, everybody brings it up, and I'm like, wow. You know, I'm just really proud of it, that we did that, and it was as genuine as it was. But at the same time, I hate dwelling on it. You know?
You better not take it from me. It's the jungle. Welcome to the jungle.
And that's probably why Appetite was such a great record, because those guys came from playing that material live to people and then went right in the studio and recorded it. That's what made it so energized and such a great natural record, rock and roll album.
Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction at that time was completely different from anything else that was out there, and it really does sum up hard rock.
With Guns N' Roses, we're like one in a million that actually made it.
The fact that Guns got so big is sort of a fluke. It was the right band at the right time.
And we just were lucky.
Music was going one way, we were the antithesis of that.
What's the appeal of the band? I think the appeal is that there is no appeal. We're not like another hair band, like, you know, on MTV or MuchMusic or whatever, you know?
We just happened to pop out of a certain time when there was nothing but synth music going on, like the really lame post-punk stuff, and we just were completely different.
We really went, you know, against all odds, and then we managed to get here, which is cool.
It's starting to get ridiculous how this one record came out and it went like this, and it's still like we haven't lost any popularity.
The Cult was cool and everything. Basically, the bands had the same attitude, you know, and I just became such good friends with these guys. They called me up to do the album originally, and I came in, I was just gonna do the album. And then I started hanging out with the guys and everything, and we got along really well, and then they, you know, said, Matt, you wanna be in the band? I went, hey, you know, yeah, you know?
Matt proved to be the drummer for the band just by his presence, you know?
I stepped into the thing back then. It was pretty amazing for me because I was playing the clubs in Hollywood, and I joined that band at their peak. And, you know, we had like a private jet, and I went from loading my gear into the van to that.
fact that Guns got so big was sort of a fluke. It was the right band at the right time. Just at a point when music was going one way, we were the antithesis of that. Don't you cry.
It was cool to be f***ed up. It was condoned, what we did. It was absolutely condoned.
People have been trying to capitalize on a typical bad boy kind of rock image.
Yeah, people come up to you know, one of us and say, it's a really good PR scare you guys got going. We didn't do anything, you know? We did absolutely nothing ourselves to create any of this as far as PR wise. People are gonna write what they write.
Like it was a preconceived thing or something. Like we set out, you know, we got together and we said, okay, well, we'll wear this and we'll wear that and we'll be cool and we'll be bad and everybody will dig it because it's different. Yeah, that's not what it's all about.
Guns N' Roses has been around for long enough time that you know that we're not some sort of like, you know, nice boy institution.
We have such a bad rep, you know.
We're just the assholes. I mean, we do things from time to time that aren't necessarily socially acceptable. You know, not that we're bad guys, you know.
The whole problem of drugs surrounding the band, is it as bad as we hear?
It was at one time. I mean, there was a period, thank God, where finally we went, okay, this, you know, I'm surprised I'm still here. It's not conducive to doing anything productive as far as the reason we were together in the first place. And I that dawned on me. I was like, this is over, and I stopped.
Stop now, or you'll be dead tomorrow. You know, I was in the hospital, and that was my ultimatum. And once you're faced with that, it was really, really scary. So I faced it, and I'm glad it happened, you know, or else I probably wouldn't have lasted another 6 months.
The weirdest thing I've heard about myself, that I was dead.
Wow.
A couple times. Yeah, I heard you were dead. I get phone calls. This one guy called me up, left me these crazy messages, and like, I hope you're okay. And I called back, I said, what is up with you? And he goes, man, I heard you were dead yesterday. That's
like the live fast, die young attitude.
I think live fast and live long.
Yeah. now it's live fast. And let's rock until we're 65 or something, you know?
You pace yourself now.
Well, all things considered, man. I'm, you know, I know about not pacing myself, and I really give myself a lot of credit for having gotten this far. You learn after a while what you can, what your limitations are. Man's got to know his limitations.
There's a certain vibe we brought back as a live band, which is, you know, it's not predictable. It's very dangerous on the most part, and that's what's fun about it, you know?
I think probably people feel the liveness, you know, and the dangerousness of it.
It's not supposed to be predictable, and it's not supposed to be, like, where it's safe. Say live and let die. That sort of unbridled energy gets us going. So it's, and then you get that friction between the crowd and the band.
Energy! I want to get out of here completely, completely tired. I want to get out of here even dead, I don't know, but they are the best.
It's sort of a magic happening, which is nice. And what you have to do is just stick to your guns and hold on there. All I do is, like, if we're not on the road, I spend my time at home working to get back on the road. You know, so I mean, I have to say I'm single-minded in that way. My wife thinks I'm crazy.
What it always came down to with Guns, or anything I've done, but Guns especially, was that hour and a half we're on stage. You know, that's when the focus was there. That was our, you know, our creed. You know, it was like, we got to put on the best show in the world tonight, and tomorrow night, and the next night.
Was your way, loud or liar?
When you're touring, there's really the only time that it's fun is for the 2 hours you're playing, you know? The only kind of redeeming thing that would happen after working your ass off for 2 hours at gigs really turned out to be just, like, getting laid. I mean, ask any band, they'll tell you the same thing. Sometimes you could watch a crowd getting really antsy and, like, ready to go.
Did you ever go up to Axl and say, get on stage, guys?
We've had all kinds of different situations when it comes to that. After the show, and as long as the show is good, then, you know, all that stuff's sort of erased.
Yeah.
You know, so if you have a bad show as well, then you walk around pissed off for a little while.
We're doing much music. Canadian.
Oh, shit!
Thanks.
Hey, well, have a good show, good tour, man.
Hope so.
Yeah.
I can't tell one day from the next.
See, I told you. He does.
Big blur.
Axl Rose was arrested early this morning.
He's a wanted fugitive following a riot. He faces 5 counts in all after a conflict.
Everything is always interesting with us. This is true. I mean, all things considered, it's a very entertaining band outside of the music.
Because it just gets out of hand. It's like, you know, the tabloids and stuff kind of attitude, where they're just feeding off a personality.
Yeah.
And it gets to the point where it gets so negative. It's like, what are you trying to concentrate on? What are you trying to communicate with the readers? This whole big facade is built up, and when you go out and play in front of people, they have no idea what you're all about.
I'm a little ticked off because of all the attention being drawn at us.
Especially nowadays, everything's so intense. You can't walk down the street without somebody accusing you of something. So it's hard to tell what the real story is. Everything's blown out of proportion.
To keep your sanity, it's better just to concentrate on your music and what you're all about and not even deal with what the media has to do with anything.
This band is very volatile, you know? And the rumors, you know, about, like, we could break up at any second is true. It's always on the edge, you know? It's always, you know, anything could happen anytime. A riot could break out.
You can't let people down, because they go to the ends of the earth to make it happen for you. You have to make sure that it happens for them. There's not really a lot I can say at this point. I mean, as long as Montreal will let us come back, in a 2.5-year tour with a volatile band like Guns N' Roses, and you know what we're all about, you just happen to be one of the unlucky places it happened at. But I mean, there's no ill means to the people in Montreal or any particular place.
Could have been anywhere.
Could have been anywhere.
You know, just always wound up, you know, to the point of just snapping. Always, you know. You know, we put out some cool records, and I think we broke some good ground, and I think we stirred some shit up, so to speak, you know, at the time. And, I just look back and say, you know, that was a great thing, you know?
Like, we always remember what we liked when we were kids and stuff, so we try to do it the same way.
Yeah.
But then again, this band is exactly what we wanted to be when we were kids and stuff.
On the Illusion tour, was it an us versus him episode?
It was us just trying to get through it. I mean, I, you know, like, because of that kind of bond that Matt and Duff and I have, because really we were the only original, more or less original band members that have been there a long time. Gilby was new and Axel was on his own trip. So we held that together.
I think we always felt like the foundation, you know, the core, and it was almost like, okay, we're gonna go on no matter what.
No matter what was up with Axel, we would stick it out, make sure that we still managed to get through it.
You know, we're playing to people, 50,000 to 140,000 people a night. And that gets very surrealistic and weird, you know?
Guns got so big that it almost became separated from its audience. It was like, sure, we could sell a lot of tickets, but we don't know any of the people we're selling the tickets to. You know, so it was great. It's very gratifying to go out and play in front of 100,000 people. That's great. But then you don't even know them.
We got so big. There's no how-to video or how-to book on how to deal with that stuff, what to look out for.
In a nutshell, what we did was we were jamming like old songs that we're familiar with, just sort of to hang out with each other in the studio when we were doing the Illusions records is where it started, you know, just to warm up and hang out. We did like four songs and they sounded really good, and it ended up being a 12 song situation. Axel says, let's do this. I said, let's do this. And so there was no list of songs that we picked through.
And there was just songs that different guys in the band liked, you know.
It was very spontaneous, very natural. Okay. You know, very sort of a pure rock and roll kind of like, yeah, what the f***, you know?
It's really something I've always wanted to do since I was 15 years old. You know, I always played drums, I always played bass guitar, and sang and wrote songs. I could do it.
Think there's gonna be any conflict with the band?
No. I mean, the guys in the band come down and check it out. Wow, can I play in this? And you know, I talked to Axel last night. You know, I talked, and they're the biggest fans of the record.
At one point, it was like, it's not a solo project, it's a side project. Now it's like, it's just another band. But I think I've accumulated enough experience over the years that I can get away with doing it.
We hung out over a case of beer, we wrote a record. Basically, that's it. With Guns N' Roses, the band got so big, it's like, where do you go from there? So this is fun just to get back down right to sort of like a roots kind of thing and just go out and play some clubs, you know?
Slash approached me and said he wanted to do some work with me. And we'd gone to school together.
You hooked up with Slash in high school or something, didn't you?
Yeah, we didn't really know each other, though.
No?
I used to see him in the hallways, you know?
Yeah.
Where we'd be most of the time.
When people ask you to be on their records, what do you think they're trying to pull in?
You know what? I'm the f***ing schmuck that doesn't really realize that. I just do it because I like playing. But then I find out, you know, people tell me later, and if I actually stop being pig-headed enough to listen to them, it's usually taking advantage of the name, which is all part of the whole Guns N' Roses thing, and that's sort of a drag.
There's been a few times where I was completely blown away as far as sessions are concerned.
Like with who?
Iggy Pop. Well, Michael calling me. Okay. You won't be laughing, girl, when I'm not around. He was great to work with.
He was great, yeah.
Playing with Michael, it was definitely, he wanted to rock guitar, so he called me, which was flattering in itself.
With Michael Jackson, I had to write my own part. You know, basically, they just let me loose in the studio.
The thing about hard rock,
it works in a lot of different types of music, a lot of different genres. And I think I get a turn on just trying to watch them intermingle.
Yeah, I got to play with Ray Charles recently. He could give a hot f*** about Guns N' Roses. His producer knew that I could play a certain thing a certain way. And then Ray had me back a few times after that. It's totally far removed from what you're used to hearing me play, though.
I think that, you know, once you get past the name Slash, underneath that is a great guitar player. You know, it's like, you know, he can really play the guitar. There's a reason he's, you know, he's well known. Beyond, you know, the name and the hairdo. I mean, he rips.
There'll be no more Learjets or limos. You know, hopefully people like it. And you just got, it's one of those things, you just take it as it comes. You really can never tell.
Hey, going for Guns N' Roses was hard, you know? So I just kind of said, well, I'm gonna record my songs. So I recorded them, and then as another year went by, I go, okay, I'm gonna do it again. And it just kind of ended up being a solo act. And I don't really have a problem with Guns N' Roses. I look back with really good memories, from what I can remember. And I have really good memories. When you've been in a band like a Guns N' Roses, it's really hard to shake that. So it, that really doesn't bother me.
I didn't realize it was its own scene. And so it was interesting, you know, after all that was over and the dust cleared, to realize what a big scene it all was. I remember Axel took me to the palace to see Nirvana one night.
Did you get it?
But the record was great.
Oh, as soon as I heard and saw that the first video, Teen Spirit, I knew something was up.
Yeah, it was cool.
I actually got pissed off at Kurt because Axel wanted Nirvana to open for Guns. And Kurt said no, they don't want to, and Axel got pissed off about that. But that's about it, as far as the animosity goes. It's not deep-rooted for me. I could give a shit.
Grunge was really, really popular, and it's just like, you know, people didn't want to hear a band like a Guns N' Roses or whatever that was popular at that time.
We stopped playing at that point. We got off an airplane and got in our cars, and we went kind of underground.
Well, all that was going on, it was like, what, 93, 94, and we were actually writing, and that's when the huge sort of rift between the band and Axl developed.
For me personally, when I get back, then I'll see where Guns and Axl are at. Guns isn't doing anything, and it's when you're working hard for no reason and spending a lot of time doing nothing and thinking about working, that's when it's fun.
I quit!
You always fight for it every single night, but that sort of mentality didn't necessarily spread throughout the whole band. But for me, it's like, as soon as that goes, I gotta go. That's why I quit. That was it. I had it.
You had enough?
Yeah. I wasn't the only one. It was the whole band quit.
We systematically all left.
It's disappointing. It's a little bit, one of the few regrets I have in life is having a band get to a certain point and then having it fall apart. But it wasn't necessarily my fault. Yeah.
And the most important thing to me are all the fans that we've screwed over, and it's not because of us. You know, we sort of go along with it, with, you know, they look at all of us when one guy screws everything up, it's a whole band, you know. So I felt really bad leaving because the fans.
Basically, if you get into something crazy like this, you better be prepared to support it. You can't just walk on for whatever reason. So you hang in there for as long as you can. And then all of a sudden I realized there was just no turning, this not going to turn it around, you know?
I think as a band, you should keep to that family thing that you started out as. And pretty soon, you know, we're taking different cars to the gig, you know? Or, yeah, I'll meet you there, and you don't show up, or, you know, whereas before, we'd do things together, and, you know, we'd never let the other guy down. The band grew apart. It wasn't that family thing anymore, and it was really sad to watch.
A lot of people are like, how could you, either you're stupid or
you know, insane. And I was like, it's not the cash or the
no,
money.
It
has
happy,
something else
miserable.
Altogether. And if you think that I'm going soft, you've got some hard
times. Oh, yeah. Does it almost seem like starting over, though?
This excitement of putting it together, having everybody really into it. Everybody's 100% into it. So it is like starting over in a way, because we had to put the f***ing band together, go out and make our own record, put our own this and that together. And then now here we are, we walk out and present it. And that was sort of, that's sort of like what it was like for me with Guns. That's what that was all about. That's the fun of it, man.
Is there still contact with at least stuff?
Yeah, no, the guys in the band, we've always been the backbone. So we've always been friends, man, you know.
It was pretty much inevitable that we should be playing together again.
Expecting to come see the old band, then don't come, because it ain't it.
Yeah.
This is what we got.
We're Guns N' Roses. It's, you know what it is.
I'll see your sister in the something red. She's out the breeze and out her best.
You know, I've seen the older guys quit on their own, you know, one at a time, and be replaced. And I've seen the process. It happened gradually. To me, it still feels like Guns N' Roses. And you put Axl out there singing, they got guitars, they're playing the old songs. It feels cool.
A lot of people think it's not fair. Axl's record, whenever it's going to be coming out, is going to be called a Guns N' Roses record. To a lot of people, that's not the Gunners.
Right.
What are your thoughts on that?
You know, at this point, it's been a while. This has all been going on. I don't really give a f*** anymore. At the time when, you know what, he probably would have done everybody a lot of good if he just named it something else and just left Guns N' Roses alone. So that way it was still credible. There's now he sort of drag it through the mud and did all kinds of stuff with it. And I just wanted to f***ing do it now. Just get it, do it and get it out there. And I mean, Axl's brilliant. It's going to be awesome when he does it. He just needs to do it. So the fact that he calls it Guns N' Roses at this point, I don't care. It's been a long time.
The perception is this is Axl and a bunch of guys he hired.
Everybody's contributed something to the record.
Yeah.
Everybody. And it's a band. The reason why it's taken so long is just that it's a different process than most bands probably do go through. The process that Axl does, which is, it's all new to me, but it's kept me around because it's an interesting process, is he throws the songs around from person to person to have, see what they're gonna, what stamp they're gonna put on it and see what kind of spin it's gonna take. And you know, hammer it out, you beat it up, you kick it around the room a bit. And it takes a while to finally come up with the gem you end up with at the end of the day. All will be revealed in time, you know?
He's taking a little too long in order. It's just a rock and roll record.
If it takes this long, it takes this long.
Do it and get it out there, you know?
The Video Music Awards performance, it's just strange. I mean, Axl's still got it. I think he's great. I think he sings great. I think he writes great. It just doesn't look like Guns N' Roses to me. I mean, that's my thing. It doesn't look like the guts of that band, you know? And I think you lose the guts when you take away someone like Slash, which is a big, big part of it.
Even now, people think that we're still in Guns N' Roses. Some kids going to Guns N' Roses show thinking you're seeing the whole band, it's not.
Yeah, Axl's the voice, and the musicians are fantastic. They're really good players, but it just doesn't seem like Guns N' Roses to me.
I wish Axl nothing but the best of luck. And that's really all I got to say about that.
We go.
got an announcement that one of the band members hadn't come, and then someone was like, oh, it's Axl Rose. So we're like, oh, no, these people are going to riot.
I was so ready to party hard.
I still love Axl. No, I don't.
What happened in Vancouver?
If we were there, we were there. Axl's in the air. He's on his way. Like, we had 3 hours before we even had to go on, and they pulled the plug on us.
It should have never been canceled, and everyone will hopefully get over it.
It was hard for me to watch that. I was really pulling for him on the whole thing.
All these years later, he finally gets out there, and they had two options. Either go and prove us all wrong, or screw it up. And he screwed it up, and that's simple as that. It's sort of par for course.
It's something that you see coming. I mean, unfortunately.
I've done Snake Pit, and I was just looking, what am I going to do next? You know, so I've never kept one Snake Pit a permanent thing. And then so I've been doing all this recording here and there, and I really wanted to start a band. And a mutual friend of all of ours died, which was Randy Castillo, drummer for Ozzy. And at his funeral, Matt came up to me and said, we're going to do a benefit concert in L.A.
Benefit basically to raise money for his funeral stuff, and he was just broke.
So we played this gig, and we were the last band to go on, and we just rocked this place, seriously. It was the first time I played in a band with outside of Guns with Duff. Or the house down thing. It's just really over the top. Because that was a pretty overwhelming feeling. The chemistry between me and Matt and Duff has always been, you know, you can't really find that anywhere else.
That chemistry is fully intact.
Oh, that was like a great thing, all having us all together.
After playing this one night on stage together, it was pretty much inevitable that we should be playing together again.
We get 100-some-odd CDs a week of people auditioning for this thing. Maybe 1 out of 20 we actually audition in the studio.
We're not going to replace Axl Rose, and that's probably the biggest misconception we've had in this search for a singer. We'll get a lot of guys who will come in thinking that's what we want, and they'll come in and sing Welcome to the Jungle.
I'm just looking for a really good, a genuine rock and roll singer, which is so few and far between.
Just somebody who's got balls, a good sense of melody, and who's real. You know,
even through this process, which was fairly long to find a singer, I mean, things got tough, you know, just we just got frustrated, but we stuck with it. You know, we didn't give up. We've never given up.
The auditioning, I'm thinking, you knew what you weren't looking for more than what you were looking for?
Yeah, we knew we didn't want. Yeah, of course. But when Scott walked in the room, it was like, everything just kind of like in the sports car, when you get up over 120 miles an hour, the car settles down. And that's what it felt like, you know? Lies in the Vaseline we are. Sometimes it blows my mind. Keep getting stuck here all the
time. I need everything we have to stop his movement.
We all grew up with the Hulk, you know? And in this day and age, with them remaking a lot of the old Marvel comics and so on, you just know that the Hulk, especially with Ang Lee directing it, is going to be phenomenal.
We found out it was Ang Lee was directing. I was like, oh my God.
We were invited to see the movie. And we were like, yes, let's go.
We just got a certain energy from watching it, and it was just all really exciting and inspiring. So we wanted to do something that would be really appropriate for it.
Had a lot of intensity about the movie and his art form.
All this bottled up tension is what the song's about. It's a pretty good marriage. Writing songs is really cool, but if you get inspired to do it, it's a really good movie. The outcome is more fulfilling, you know?
After we did these two movies, we decided, well, let's be a band. And of course, now all the labels started coming around, and you know, playing that game, and we couldn't have been more disinterested with a lot of them, you know. We knew their game. We've been around, man. We've been around the block. But we finally settled with a company that's really behind it, really gets it.
We didn't have anyone from the label snooping around the studio while we made this record.
One time, early days of Guns N' Roses, Tom Zutaut, our A&R guy, said, why don't you guys make a change in, I forget what song it was, and Izzy happened to have his acoustic guitar. And Izzy, we were in this Tom Zutaut's office, Izzy took out his acoustic guitar and said, here, why don't you play me what you mean? I can't play guitar.
Izzy said exactly. So let's just do our thing.
It's like no one can tell us what to do because we don't have to.
There wasn't one comment made regarding any artistic direction at all.
You know, if you're thinking about a band that made Appetite and a band that made, you know, his first record, it's like you're going to leave those guys alone to do what they do.
It was just exciting the second we all, you know, more or less got together. You know what I'm saying? That was like, whoa, there's a feeling I hadn't felt in a long time.
For myself, this has been probably the best thing I've ever been involved in.
The chances of us getting together, or just the chances of any one of us getting that kind of a vibe once again in your whole career is really slim. So all of a sudden when it happens, it was like, wow. Now that it's finished, I look back on it and go, wow, you know, this is very rare that you get a chance to come back around like that, you know?
You know, the vibe is right. You know, the vibe is cool. And that makes for, you know, a great thing to happen, I think. When it feels as good as it feels.
The word danger is being kicked around. And that's missing from rock radio right now.
Yeah. Has been for a while.
It's missing from rock right now. In general.
What is the expression, dangerous as dangerous does or something?
Yeah.
What is that danger that you're talking about?
I would say just not compromising, you know? None of us are angels, and we've come up through the ranks, you know, and the tough way. The way that we release is through our music. The band attacks each song like it's, like, you know, you're in the ring, you know? So we're not trying to write a radio hit.
And do you even listen to rock radio anymore?
Well, yeah. I mean, rock radio gets a little bit too limited.
Hey, yeah, I heard him playing a White Stripes riff one day, and that impressed me.
Yeah, right?
Him and Jack hung out.
Well, and he's making appearances in the Strokes video, too.
That was me, because I was hanging out with those guys.
Yeah. That was cool, though. I like the Strokes guys.
I told Slash about him. He had never really heard him, and then we met him and hung out with him, and they were huge fans of us, so it just seemed like a cool thing to do.
It's a really great feeling to be in a band with guys that, number one, you like, or number two, you trust.
There's a friendship going on here, too, as well, which you haven't had in a long time.
Well, all things considered, no. I mean, I haven't been in that kind of a situation where you're in with a... Having a band is like having this sort of tight family gang kind of thing.
You have fun hanging out, being with your friends.
And you haven't had that in a while.
No. There was a time. But yeah, it's cool, you know?
When you can basically have the strength to go through God knows what and come out at the end together and unscathed, then you got a really good thing going. And that's what happened with this.
I mean, I wouldn't mind being remembered as being a good rock and roll band.